In this video, I'm going to show you how to run a Zoom meeting. You actually have quite a bit of control as the host. I'm going to be going over some best practices using some popular in-meeting features. So this video is going to be a bit longer than a usual how-to video. All right, so the first thing that I do when I start a meeting is I turn off Outlook. Even if I'm not going to be screen sharing, if there is an incoming email or some other notification dings, that can be really distracting. I don't just minimize Outlook because you'll still get those notifications even if it's minimized. I fully close out of it. I also turn the ringer off on my phone. Even if it's on vibrate, if it happens to be on a table or some other hard surface, a vibrating phone can make a bunch of noise. Now, I've heard that some folks put their phone in another room when they're hosting. I actually recommend that you keep your phone close to you in the event that your computer audio stops working. This has actually happened to me multiple times this week, where I started a meeting using my computer audio and suddenly in the middle of the meeting, I had to switch over to connecting via my phone. And then last but not least, I also close the windows in the room where I am to help minimize any outside noise coming in from the street or neighbors. If you scheduled your meeting ahead of time, go ahead and click on the Meetings link in the left nav bar of your Zoom account, and you'll be taken to your upcoming meeting screen. Find your meeting in the list of meetings there, and then go ahead and click the Start button. If you decide to do the quick launch version for starting a meeting by clicking on the Host a Meeting button, then you will be launched right into your meeting. All right, sometimes the starting screen for your meeting will be different based on how you started it. If you scheduled your meeting ahead of time, you'll be taken to your Meeting Hub screen. You'll also be taken here if you clicked the Host Meeting button to do a quick launch and you selected to do so with your video off. Now, if you clicked that Host Meeting button to quick launch your meeting and you selected to do so with your video on, your start screen is going to look something like this. Now you may wonder, what happens if you have your video on and then you decide to turn it off? Well, if you have an avatar set up in your account, it will show that avatar instead of your video. If you haven't yet set up an avatar, it will show your name in medium-sized font against a plain black background. Now, what happens sometimes is it will start your meeting and it will appear as if you can't do anything. That's because sometimes the options bar is hidden. What is the options bar? That is this bar that appears at the bottom of your screen. If for some reason it's not there, which does happen, just shake your mouse over the bottom of your screen and that will usually bring it back up. FYI, sometimes the options bar will appear at the bottom and sometimes it's at the top. I don't know why it appears in either space, it seems to be kind of random. So what is the options bar? It contains some handy icons for tasks that you can do during the meeting. And the smaller your start window, the fewer options you will have. So I'm actually going to come up here and click this maximize button to maximize my screen. And now I can see a whole lot of options. Let's go over these features from left to right. First, we have the microphone. In this particular meeting, I'm using the computer audio with an external USB mic. Notice that as I'm talking, a green bar inside of the mic icon is going up and down with the sound levels. This tells me that my microphone is working. If I wanted to mute myself, I would click the microphone and a red line will appear through it, kind of like the Ghostbuster symbol. This is what that looks like. Now that I have clicked on it again and have unmuted myself, you can hear me again. The next symbol we have is the video camera icon. Currently, it has a red slash through it because it's off. To turn it on, I would just click on it and it would activate my webcam. If you're on a laptop, you'll want to be ready to adjust the angle in case you wind up appearing like you are looming over the camera. The video feature is basically an on-off switch, so you can change your mind at any time and turn it on or off. If you're going to be using Zoom at home, you're going to want to be aware of objects in the background. Here we can see my slightly messy kitchen because I just made a whole bunch of soup. If you're going to be filming in front of a bookshelf, be aware that folks will likely zoom in to read the titles of your books. Also, you'll want to be aware of any reflective surfaces behind you, such as a hutch with a glass front or a TV set. These can inadvertently reflect objects or people in the background, such as a toddler running from one room to the next. If you're like me and you like to gesture when you talk, be aware that if you gesture forward, your hands are going to look huge. Also, if you're going to be demonstrating objects during a meeting, such as this picture hanging thing, you can sometimes want to bring it up close to the camera to give folks a really good look at it, but just know that if you bring it forward quickly, you can actually trigger motion sickness in your attendees if they get motion sick. So you'll want to try to hold objects steady and have them a bit back from the camera. The next icon was an invite icon. It looks like this icon was removed during a recent Zoom update. However, don't worry, you can still invite people from within the Zoom meeting. First, if you're on your hub screen, you can use this cute little invite icon in the sort of lower right area. If you aren't on your hub screen, because for example, your screen sharing or your video's on, you can invite people from the pop-up that will appear when you click on Manage Participants. I'll go over this icon in part 2 of this video. Next, we have a new security icon. The features/settings listed here may change as Zoom pushes out new updates. A check mark next to the features indicates that yes, that feature is enabled. First, it gives you the option to lock your meeting. If you're having a meeting and all of your attendees are already there, you may choose to lock your meeting so that nobody else can enter. Next, you can decide whether or not you want a waiting room. Here we can see that yes, a waiting room has been enabled. What that means is that anyone else who tries to come in is going to get a message on their screen letting them know that they're waiting to be admitted by the host. You as the host are going to see a little flashing alert down here over the participants area, indicating that somebody is trying to enter your meeting. It's kind of like a visual doorbell ringing, if you will. When you click on that alert, you will see that person's name as well as an admit button so you can let them in or remove them if you would like. Just as an FYI, I've had to click on this admit button like 3 or 4 times before it actually let the person in. Next, you'll decide whether or not you want to allow participants to share their own screens. If you keep it unchecked, that means that you, the host, are the only one who can screen share during the meeting. In other words, the only thing that participants will see during a screen share is something that you are showing them that's on your computer. If you enable this feature, that allows your participants to share what they have on their computers. So what's been happening in some Zoombombing events is that the participant will decide to share their screen and it turns out that they have porn or something else offensive on their screen at that time. We'll go over more about screen sharing in part 2 of this video. Your next decision is about the chat feature. Do you want there to be a chat box during your meeting? There are pros and cons to having a chat box. One of the cons is that, yes, a Zoombombing attendee could type something offensive, but there are many reasons why a chat box can come in really handy. Maybe an attendee has a question and they don't want to interrupt you, so they just type it into the chat box. A chat box is also a great way for you to get in-the-moment feedback on the sound quality of your meeting. That's where you will likely get folks telling you, hey, the computer audio is cutting out. And last but not least, you can decide if you want participants to be able to rename themselves during the meeting. One of the pros is that if somebody logged in with Margaret Smith, for example, and then she realized, you know, everybody in the class knows me as Peggy, she could change her name on there to Peggy Smith. One of the cons is that somebody could change their name during the meeting to something offensive. So again, there are pros and cons to enabling or not enabling each of these features. I look forward to seeing you in part 2 of this video.